trustworthy, tell the truth, and keep their promises. People can depend on you.
The Scout is loyal. Be true to your family, friends, Scout leader, school, and country.
The Scout is helpful. Volunteer to help others without expecting a reward.
The Scout is friendly. Be a friend to everyone, even people who are very different from you. The Scout is courteous.
God is for you. Be polite to everyone and always do good matters.
The Scout is kind. Treat others as you want to be treated. Never harm or kill any living thing without food.
The Scout is obedient. Follow the rules of your family, school, and path. Obey the laws of your country and community.
A Scout is cheerful. And look for the bright side of life. Cheerfully do tasks that come your way. Try to help others be happy.
Scout is thrifty. Work to pay your own way. Don't be wasteful. Use time, property, and natural resources wisely.
Scout is brave. Face difficult situations even when you feel afraid. Do what is right, despite what others might be doing or saying.
A Scout is clean. Keep your body and mind fit. Help keep your home and community clean.
A Scout is reverent. Be reverent toward God. Be faithful in your religious teaching. Respect the beliefs of others.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Truthfully, I was once a Scout. Almost 80 years ago. And I learned something that stood me in good stead the whole of my life. I learned how to read maps. And I could go, if my wife confirmed this, I could go to a foreign country and find my way around because of what I learned in the Scouts. One time we were in Beijing, China. Never been there before. And my wife and I were alone. I had a map that didn't say very much. I said, our hotel is over there. And so we started walking, and we walked through the back streets of Beijing, China. And we came upon this car that was stalled, and these kids were trying to push it. So I started pushing it too. What does it say here? A Scout is helpful, right? So I when I pushed it, they were so pleased, they clapped. And we got back to our hotel okay. And I thank God for having been a Scout. Are you going to say the pledge here?
Yeah, we did it.
Oh, you're not a believer, the pledge of Scout.
Yeah, we're going to say that. Later on, I think in the service, right? What do we say now?
Well, as I looked at it, and thank you for handing it to me, it's based on a lot of the things that Jesus stood for and said. So the Scout is trustworthy. Well, Jesus said, let your yes be yes, and your no be no. The Scout is helpful. Love your neighbor as yourself, said Jesus. So that. There you go. And then all these others. And at the very end, the Scout is reverent. Jesus said, love the Lord your God with all your heart, mind, and soul. So this, in many ways, is reflective of what Jesus did. Well, warm welcome. two of you people are going to be the readers of the scriptures today, right?
Yes.
And I would like you to stay here because I have another job for you to do. Okay?
Victoria, you gotta go.
After you say read the scriptures, stick with me. I got something very important I want you to do. No matter how old you are, you can do important things.
You want to move
there?
Anything
else?
We'll have them come up now.
While they get settled, I just wanted to remind everybody that we will be having a Wednesday service here Wednesday afternoon at 4 o'clock. Todd Young will be officiating, so hope to see lots of you there. We moved the time back so that folks who don't like to drive in the dark can get here and participate and then get home safely.
You're yelling at your brother.
There you go. I'm sort of used to kids. We had four of our own and five grandchildren. I taught school in my checkered career. I was a substitute teacher. And my vision of hell is to be called at 6:30 every morning to go in and teach an 8th grade math class. Anyway, I think it's time for us to start worship, right? Let's call ourselves to worship. The God who said, out of darkness the light shall shine,
is the same God who made light and time in our hearts
to bring us the knowledge of God's glory.
Shine in the face of Christ.
Let's sing hymn 446, Glorious Things of Dear Spoken. Stand one. Amazing Grace. He, in his young days, was a slave boat captain. I can't think of a worse job. And Christ touched his life deeply. He became a minister and fought against the slave trade and helped Britain to stop the led to prayer. So God moves in great ways. His wonders perform. If we say that we are perfect without any sin, we're only kidding ourselves. But God is just and merciful. And if we confess ourselves, He truly forgives, cleans the slate, so we can move forward in life. Let us join in our prayer of confession. God of compassion, in Jesus Christ, you reveal the light of your glory. But we turn away, distracted by our own plan. Ask that we speak when we should listen, act when we should wait. Forgive our aimless enthusiasm. Grant us wisdom to live in your life and to follow in the way of your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen. The good news is that even if we at first do not hear the divine word addressed to us, God calls again and again. Friends, believe the good news of the gospel in Jesus Christ. We are forgiven. Amen. And as I read that, I thought of John Newton, how his life was completely turned around from evil to good. Well, the peace of Christ be with you.
And also with you.
Peace. Let your word guide us, O God, and may we hear what you would have us to do today in our lives and the world. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen.
Logan first.
Logan first.
Are you reading the second?
Oh, yeah.
Logan,
you read first. Okay. Come over here where the microphone is.
Therefore, since through God's mercy we have this ministry, we do not lose heart. Rather, we have renounced secret and shameful ways. We do not use deception, nor do we distort the word of God. On the contrary, by setting forth the truth plainly, we commend ourselves to everyone's conscience in the sight of God. And even if our gospel is veiled, it is veiled to those who are perishing. The God of this age has blinded the minds of unbelievers, so that they do not see the light of the gospel that displays the glory of Christ, who is the image of God. For what we preach is not ourselves, but Jesus Christ as Lord, and ourselves as your servants for Jesus' sake. For God, who said, "Let light shine out of darkness," made his light shine in our hearts to give us the light of the knowledge of God's glory displayed in the face of Christ. But we have this treasure in jars of clay to show that this all-surpassing power is from God and not from us.
Excellent.
Amen.
Peter and James and John, and led them up a high mountain apart by themselves. And he was transfigured before them, and his clothes became dazzling white, such as no one on earth and bleach them, and though and there are appeared to them Elijah with Moses, who were talking with Jesus. Then Peter said to Jesus, "Rabbi, it is good to hear. Let us make three dwellings, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." He did not know what to say. They were terrified. Then a cloud overshadowed them, and from the cloud there came a voice, "This is my son, the beloved. Listen to him." Suddenly, when they looked around, they saw no one with them anymore, but only Jesus.
That's a very strange story, isn't it? That the central core of the disciples went up on top of this mountain, and there Jesus, it said that his clothes got so white they shone. And then there appeared two them, Moses and Elijah. Now, that was very scary. Those guys have been dead for hundreds of years. And Peter, I love Peter, he's so human. He was so scared that he said, "Let's build three." It's great. He said, "It's great that we're here," but he really didn't mean it. He was scared. He said, "I'm terrified" is the word that's used here. And he said, "Let's build three booths, three little shacks, and put you three guys in it: Jesus, Moses, and Elijah. Sort of get them out, get them away." But it developed a little bit more, and I'll get into that, but that mountain that they were on is Mount Tabor, and I have a picture of it, and I know it's a smaller picture, some of you can't see it, but in 1983, Mrs. Henricksen and I were in Israel, and we were in a hotel in Tel Aviv, which is a big city in Israel, but we took a bus up to Galilee, where Jesus lived, Nazareth, where he had in Capernaum, where he preached. We actually saw the place where Jesus preached, and other things like that. And on the way back, we passed Mount Tabor. And it was near sunset, and this is what it looked like, very mysterious. Now, I'd like you guys, if you could go on one side and give it to the people, and you go to the other side, okay, down here, give it to the people, you can do it. A Scout is helpful, right? Mm-hmm. There you go. Thank you very much. That was a very interesting and strange time. But it says about Jesus something beyond being just a good person, a good preacher, a good prophet. Do you know that In many ways, Jesus was like a Jewish rabbi, called him in this passage rabbi. And even the Muslims recognized Jesus as a great prophet because of the things that he said and did. But here is a point where it says to us he was more than just a human prophet. Somehow God was in him, bringing God's life message. And you can keep those pictures if you like, whatever you want to do with them. Okay? I have them on my computer. I didn't turn them up. So it's very important to realize that Jesus was a real connection with God through his personality, personhood, and all the rest. It says that the cloud overshadowed them. This is my son, the beloved. Listen to him. And suddenly they looked down and they saw no one with them anymore, but only Jesus. He ordered them not to share this until after he had risen from the dead. Purely human, fully human. The minister once asked people in a Bible study, do you think that Jesus ever went to the bathroom? And somebody was horrified to think that, but he was fully human. But there was this element. This he brought to us in himself the reality of God. This is a treasure. As Paul said in that passage that was so well read, that we have this treasure in our lives. We have the reality of God. Jesus Christ in our lives. But I love the way he puts it. But we have this treasure in clay jars so that it may be made clear this extraordinary power belongs to God and does not come from us. I didn't do it today, but I'm thinking sometime of preaching on this to a bunch of preachers and getting one of Jenny's clay pots. Utilitarian, good, helpful, something that can be used. But then I'm going to drop it and it breaks into pieces. We are weak human beings, and yet we have this treasure within us. There is an illustration, Jenny, I'm going to have to say it again, the third preaching in a row, of an illustration. I don't think, I go to all these different churches, and I sometimes tend to repeat myself because I don't know where I've said what I've said. But it was many years ago, almost 50 years ago, I was pastor in the Presbyterian Church in Newburgh. I was all around 30, late 30s, and this elderly lady, little lady, was very old. She was like 58. Can you say? Everything's relative, right? And we were in this little room. She was a librarian, and she'd set up this room in Calvary Presbyterian Church as a library. And we were standing in front of this picture. It was Dali's Last Supper. I didn't bring it with me. I should have. Sorry about that. And she said to me something so profound. She said, you cannot be happy at a funeral, but you can be joyful. And that struck me, yes. Happiness is based on the happenings of the world around, in our lives. But joy is based upon a relationship with God, who cares deeply for us. Several years later, they had moved that picture from that library. It was low. She could read it. There was a little plaque on the bottom of it. I couldn't see it. It's not tall. They moved the picture to on the stairway, and I looked, and the plaque read that this picture was given to her by her co-workers at the library, the public library in Newburgh, in honor and memory of her son, who on his first mission flying in Vietnam was shot down and killed. So that when she said, you can't be happy at a funeral, but you can be joyful because we are connected in with the greatness of God through Jesus Christ. Think on these things. Amen. Amen. Let's sing together the first and third stanzas of Joyful, Joyful, We Adore Thee. 4, 6, 4. Others have passed on, help them, help us all to be cognizant of their lives and how they meant to us, to celebrate, enjoy their lives, as well as mourn their passing from us. We pray for these young people as they grow to be responsible adults, that truly they may live out what you have said for us and done for us. We pray for our nation, that we may be one, working together to solve the problems that face us. We do thank you, God, for this privilege of worship. We pray this in Jesus' name. Taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, Hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Let's sing stanzas 1 and 4, Go for a Thousand Tongues to Sing. 466. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.